Okay, good morning everyone. And I think everyone should be able to hear me and see me. Good morning. And let's get started with Azure Machine Learning Service on this Azure Day, focusing on the Azure Machine Learning track. So my name is Henk Boelman, and I'm a cloud advocate at Microsoft, and I'm based in the Netherlands. And I'm here to help you get started with machine learning on Azure. So that is exactly what I'm going to do today. So what are we going to do? We're going to see what is possible with machine learning on Azure. Second, we're going to see how the data science process looks like. So what stages do you have to go through when you get started, when you want to do a machine learning project? And then we're going to build a simple Simpson's classification model using Azure Machine Learning. But first, to kick off, what is machine learning anyway? So machine learning is to give your computer the ability to learn things without explicitly programming them. So I'm a developer, and I have been programming a lot, and I made a lot of algorithms, or in other words, functions. You create that function, if then else, for each, and it delivers you something. You run data through it, and you get an answer. But with machine learning, it is actually switched. So instead of me programming the algorithm, we let the computer do that for us. So we give it a bunch of answers, we back it up with a lot of data, we run it through a training process, and we will get an algorithm, a function for you. It will build it. So that is really awesome. And in other words, you can call that the model. X goes in, Y goes out. So when you have the model, you can run data through it, and then you get predictions. So remember I said before you get answers? So now we're getting predictions with a certain certainty. So like it's like 70% sure that that is the answer. But in the old days, it was of course true or false. So that is something to be aware of when you're doing machine learning. So what is available on our Microsoft Azure stack? So before we go in, I think there's a Q&A thing, so drop your questions in there. Machine learning on Azure. Basically divided in five types, five layers. So the first layer are the Microsoft Cognitive Services, or in other words, the sophisticated pre-trained models. And they really help you to infuse AI in your applications easily. It is a set of around 40 APIs that are hosted by Microsoft and just give you AI power by just calling out to an API. So if you want to do computer vision, you do a REST call, send an image, and you get your answer back. And those models that are behind those APIs are trained and maintained by Microsoft. But sometimes you have to do it yourself. So then you need to start picking a framework. And the good news is everything works on Microsoft, on our machine learning platform. So if you want to train models in PyTorch, TensorFlow, Keras, it is all fine. And then there are productivity services. They really help you work together as a team. So there is Azure Databricks that will automate your whole data pipeline. There is Azure Machine Learning that will help you there with the end-to-end service for a machine learning workflow. And there are machine learning virtual machines. And these virtual machines really help you to get started quickly because they have a pre-installed environment. So you don't have to worry about installing lots of Python packages, TensorFlow, GPU drivers. Everything is already pre-installed for you. To do machine learning on scale, you need a lot of compute. So we have GPUs, CPUs, and we can, of course, help you deploy it to the cloud, to the edge, or can give you the model so you can run it even locally. So what are Microsoft Cognitive Services? So Microsoft Cognitive Services are pre-trained models that run in the cloud, and some of them you can pick up, you get a Docker container, and can run it in your own infrastructure. So that is what we call the edge. They're divided in four regions. So we have vision to make your application see. Speech to make your application listen and talk to you. There is a language to understand what is being spoken, and there is knowledge so you can use the internet as a big brain for your application. but we are going to level up a little bit today. We are going to not use these pre-trained services, but we are going to build our own model. And for that, we first need to understand how the process looks like. So what do we need to do to actually get to the part where we can build a model? And that is called the data science process. So how it looks in a quick overview. You first start with asking a sharp question. You need to collect data to answer that question. And then, of course, data is always messy. So you have to prepare it so it can run through your algorithm. And then you actually can train your model. And then don't forget to use the answer in production or in your application. So what is a sharp question? So a sharp question can be anything like this. It's like, how much or how many? Is it this or is it that? Is it weird? To which group does it belong to? Or which action should I take? So for our example now, we're going to just take the simple question, what is the price or what should be the price of a secondhand car? And for that, we need data. So data can come from many different places. So I got my data from Kaggle because there was a sample data set, but it can come from UCI, it can come from the Azure Machine Learning examples. So these are really data sets to get you started and to help you figure out how machine learning works. But the data can also come, of course, from your own company. So I have this data set from Kaggle, and it is just a simple CSV file with lots of columns in it. And now I have to start preparing the data. And for every column in the data set, I have to ask myself a few questions. Is this column relevant to answer my question? Is this column independent? Is it simple enough for the machine learning algorithm to understand? And is my data clean? So preparing the data, is it relevant? Is the price relevant for my supervised machine learning? Yeah, that is quite relevant. Is the city, the state, and the VIN number relevant? Yeah, later on we might add like state information, but yeah, the VIN number is for sure not relevant at the moment. So I just throw those columns away. I can always add them later. Is my column independent? Meaning, are not two columns telling me exactly the same thing? So here it says like year is 2015, age is 3. Yeah, so I pick one. Because if I use two of these same columns, this suddenly becomes a very important parameter, or likely the training process is to pick it up as an important thing. And there are other ways to boost like some columns. And is my data simple enough? Like, do I really need to have like the sub model, or can I just go with, for the first training rounds, with the base model? And then is my data clean? Meaning, is there no faulty data in it? Because if I feed it wrong information as correct samples, then it will just say, then it will just learn the wrong thing and it will predict the wrong thing for us. So we need to go to the data set and get those weird values out. And there are lots of tools to actually make that a bit easier for you. So now we have our data and we're mostly around 80% of our time already, because preparing your data takes a lot of time and is a very important task. So now we can select the algorithm. And I'm not a machine learning algorithm expert, so I just go for the cheat sheets. And there are a lot of these cheat sheets out there that will actually help you figure out in which direction you should look like. So this is the Microsoft Azure Machine Learning Algorithm Cheat Sheet. So I start with start and then see what I want to do. So I want to predict values. I want to predict the price. So then I go there and I see, okay, regression would be like probably the perfect thing, but which type? So I just pick out five and then we'll start seeing which of those models is actually the best. Of which of those algorithms is actually the best. So I pick those five algorithms and then I start just training the model. And this is how a typical training workflow looks like. You start with importing your data, do some more pre-processing. You split the data, 20% for training, 80% for training, 20% for testing. We train with our algorithm on that 80%, we take the test data and we start scoring the model, and then we will visualize the result. So this is the old Azure Machine Learning Studio. There is a new version available, the designer. And this is how it looks. So these are easy interfaces where you can just drag and drop your steps. So I get my clean data set, I added some meta information, I split the data. And then you see on the left and the right, I have two algorithms that train on exactly the same data. They score against the same test set. And then when we evaluate the model, we can see which model performed the best on this testing data. And then don't forget to use the answer. You can use the answer in many different ways. You can wrap it up in a Docker container. You can take advantage of the hosted APIs that are there. You can put it in an Azure function, or can even export it and run it on like Raspberry Pi devices. So the possibilities are endless where you can actually run these functions you have created. So one thing to remember when you start doing this, limited data leads to terrible and biased AI results. So I can't emphasize enough, take enough time to get your data set right. So now we know this, I want to zoom in to Azure Machine Learning Studio. And Azure Machine Learning Studio is a fully based cloud service that actually will help us streamline this whole process from versioning data up to building our model and sharing it later and running it in production. And for this, we're going to answer the question, is it Marge, Homer, or other Simpsons? And for this, we're going to use my famous Lego Simpsons dataset. It is available on my GitHub. So if you want to play and start doing something with computer vision, you can use this small dataset to just train your model. So machine learning on Azure, back to this drawing. We're going to use Azure Machine Learning. We're going to use the framework PyTorch. We're going to use GPUs in Azure to train our model on, and then we're going to deploy it to the cloud. And this is a typical set of, So this is like how the flow should be according to me. So we have data scientists that will actually start figuring out how to train the model using Azure Machine Learning Service and deliver their model in model management. Then there is a development team that will actually build software around the model, will deploy it, and most likely it will end up as a container in Azure Container Registry. And then there is operations that will need to pick up that container and deploy it to a Azure Kubernetes service or basically anything that can run containers. So these are like the three disciplines that have to work together. And then of course there is the final end user that will have to send images to the endpoint. So how can we do that? To get started with Azure Machine Learning, you need to go to three phases. First, we need to prepare our environment. Then we need to experiment with our model and our data. And then we need to pick up that model and deploy it in production. So preparing our environment. We can do that in multiple ways. We can go to the Azure portal. Click, and it is there. We can do that from VS Code. You can install like an extra plugin in VS Code AI tools and start from there. Or we can use the Python SDK. And the Python SDK, you can run, you can use a Jupyter Notebook for that, or use normal Python or plain Python scripts. And the cool thing about that is that if you create something in code, it is typed and you can version it. So I personally always like things that can be versioned. So creating a workspace. If you say workspace, create, give it a name, point to the subscription ID, point to the resource group, and tell where you want to have it. It creates your workspace, and then you can write out a config file. That configuration file, you can check into your Git repository. Your teammates can actually check it out, and then you can say create workspace from config. So this is what you get, ml.azure.com. So you see it lives outside of the Azure portal. So let's zoom in to the things you get. So first, there is the place where you can store datasets. So you can register your datasets. In this case, we're going to register our Simpsons dataset as a dataset there. So we have our data nicely versioned. Then there are experiments. They keep track of our training runs. So every time I do a training run, change something in my model, I can find everything back under experiments. Then there is model, or in other words, model management. If I'm happy with my model, I can check it in there. I'll get a version number and everyone else can connect to that model repository and pull them out. So I can say, give me version 5 of that Simpsons model. I pull it out and can use it in my solution. So I always see it as like the NuGet package manager for models. And then there are endpoints. So there are real-time endpoints. Here you can find where your models are deployed in Azure Container Instances or Azure Kubernetes services. And there are pipeline endpoints because you can also create training workflows. There is compute, where you can manage the different types of compute that you need in the process. And there are data stores. And under data stores, you can manage your connection to your data. So in your code, you always only have to reference to a data store or a data set. So you never have to use any credentials in your Jupyter notebooks, which is awesome, of course. So the second thing we need is to create compute. And here I say, let's create a compute, virtual machine size, standard NC6, minimum nodes 1, maximum nodes 6. So there are two lines of code you need to do to create this cluster. So the virtual machine size is region dependent. Not all regions have the GPU enabled machines. So if you start creating an Azure Machine Learning Service workspace, you want to check first which virtual machines you want to use. Here I say minimum nodes 1 and maximum nodes 6, meaning there is always one node up and running. You can put it to 0. Then it will automatically shut down your whole cluster and you don't pay anything, only if you submit something to that cluster. The third thing you need is to have a place where you can store your data. So by default, it comes with a data store, with a blob storage as a data store, but you can connect to any other data store in the cloud, any blob data store, and you just connect with your account name and your account key. So let's go to an example and start training this Simpsons model. So I have a Jupyter notebook here. This Jupyter notebook is also available on my GitHub, which I will show at the end. So you can also try and use this yourself. So I start with importing a lot of dependencies. I like to put everything on top so the rest of my demo is a little bit cleaner. So I connect to my workspace, connect to my compute target, connect to my default data store, and connect to my first experiment. So my workspace is called Cybertron. My compute target is called Optimus Prime. That is my GPU-enabled cluster. I'm using my workspace blob store as default data store, and my experiment is called Simpsons PyTorch. So if you go to Azure Machine Learning, you can also find those things back here. So we will find under compute, four types of compute instances, of compute types. So there is a compute instance. These are used to run your Jupyter notebook. So CliffJumper is here just doing nothing. And then there are my compute clusters. So I have one called Optimus Prime that consists of standard NC6 machines. And there is Bumblebee that is based on standard D3 virtual machines, which are CPU enabled, is a CPU enabled cluster. And then inference cluster, I have an AKS service running where I can actually deploy my models to. And I didn't have any compute attached at the moment. So let's go to the Jupyter notebook and start working on the data because we need data. And I already cleaned it, so we don't have to do that. So I download my data set from my blob storage. I unzip it and I upload it to my data store. We're not going to do that now because nobody wants to see me upload 500 images. And from that data on the data store, I can actually create a data set. And when I have created that data set, I can register that data set in Azure Machine Learning. And later on, I can just use this command to connect to that specific data set. So if we go to Azure Machine Learning, we can go to data sets. Wait a little bit, and here we see there is a LEGO Simpsons version 3, which is actually version 1, but who cares? And so here we see where it is, on which blob storage the data set is, where and which path it is, how many files, how big, which version, when it is created. And this is a quick example of how you can consume it, and then there are some cool tutorials for you. So what we can do now is we can preview this data set. So let's run this cell and see what data is in there. Yes, so we can preview the data set. So here we see there are 10 Simpsons in, and we all know them, the Bart, Lisa, Milhouse, and there are 50 pictures of each Simpson. So now what do we have? We have a workspace, we have compute, and we have a storage where our data is. So now the fun part starts, and we can start experimenting with our model and our data. And the first thing you need to do for that is to create an experiment. And the experiment is the glue that holds everything together. So you've created an experiment. So the second thing you need is to create a training file. Here you see a Keras training file, but basically this can be any training file for any framework you want. It will just execute it from top to bottom on your compute cluster. So when you have your training file, you have to wrap that in an estimator. And another, how you can explain an estimator is, it is like the configuration for the Docker container where your training script is going to run in. So here I say create a PyTorch estimator. So it will pick a base container with PyTorch installed for me. I point it to the source directory, meaning where are your training script. I can give it some parameters. I can specify on which compute target it has to run, and I will tell it which script it has to execute when it is up and running. So in this case, this is train.py. I can tell it to use a GPU configuration or just a normal CPU configuration, and I can tell it which additional packages it has to install it in that base image. So I say here, conda packages install OpenCV for me, and this probably should be OpenCV Python, and specify which framework we have to use. So when I have my estimator, I have to submit that estimator to the cluster. It will build my Docker image, it will deploy my Docker image, and it will start it, and it will start streaming the output back to my experiment. And if I have a widget installed, I can actually grab the output in real time and show it in my Jupyter notebook. So this would be a good time to actually do that. So training the model, like I said, you need a training script first. So how do you get one of these training scripts? So I got this training script from the PyTorch website. I just went to Transfer Learning for Computer Vision tutorial, copied and pasted this from the GitHub repository and combined it in one training file. And I've added 3 additional things. I added a few references that I was able to parse incoming arguments and connect to the Azure ML Core run instance. And then I grabbed the run context. I parsed the arguments, and that is basically Python. We prepare the data set, and in the loop where we do actually the training rounds, I've added these 2 lines. So I say run.log, and I log the accuracy and the loss under a name. So every time it passes, it comes by in this loop, it will add a new float to this variable. And the cool thing is that Azure Machine Learning will understand that and will automatically start drawing graphs from this data for you. I will show you a bit later. And then the third thing you need to do is to save the output, save your model in the outputs folder. So everything you save in the outputs folder will automatically be copied back to your experiment, because this estimator will just shut down and everything is gone. So save everything in the outputs folder. So I save these two files here. And then we can start creating the estimator, because now we have our training script. I have two parameters here, the number of apples, and I have a data folder, and here I mount our data set as a virtual directory. So in this estimator, this data is available, these images are available in a directory. We will see that later when we run the training script. I point to my project folder where my training script is, I parse the parameters, give it a compute target, tell it to execute train.py. I'm using here the pip package manager and tell which additional things I want to have installed and which framework of PyTorch I want to use. So we create this and then we can actually submit it. So we wait a few seconds for it to be submitted. So the first time you do this, it takes actually a little bit longer because it will start building this estimator for you. But because I've run this already a few times, the base image is there and nothing has changed. So it will run very fast. It will just pick out the Docker image and will deploy it. So here in this widget, we can see what it is actually doing. So it is already running and deployed. And here we see it is processing our Simpsons dataset. And here we see that it is mounted the dataset to this temporary folder. And now it is running and it should switch over to my training file. And then we wait until it has done like two training rounds. And we will see that it will start streaming those values. So here it is done the first iteration. And we see the training accuracy, the training loss, the validation accuracy, and the validation loss here. And when it comes to like the second training round, now you see it is detected that and it will start drawing graphs for you. So let this training run and we'll go back here. So what actually happened? Because there were a lot of steps and a lot of things that happened simultaneously and after each other. So when I hit submit, it snapshotted the folder and copied it to the experiment. So everything that was in the training scripts folder, it is versioned and copied in the experiment. Then it started creating a Docker image based on my estimator specification. It deployed that Docker container to my compute target. It mounted our data stores and data sets as virtual directories, and it launched the training script. And then it started streaming the output of the training of that estimator to the experiment, and I could connect with a widget to my experiment and see everything there. And then finally, when it is done, it copies over all the outputs. So the last thing we need to do before we can start writing software around it, we need to register this model in model management. So we say model is run.registerModel. We point where the model is and we give it a name. That's it. Let's do that and let's see if our trained model is actually any good. So it is still running. And now it is completed, so perfectly timed. We see here it has done 15 training rounds. You can always connect to a previous run. So let's register it. We say run.registerModel. We here say give it a name, where it can find it. We saved everything in the outputs folder. We can specify some extra parameters so it can know how this model was trained. Can give a description and we can tag it. So here I've tagged this model as Azure Day. And I can specify like the minimum resource configuration I would recommend for you to use if you deploy this model. So I'll just say one GPU or 2 GB of memory. It's a small model, so sure that it should work. So we will register this model and it is now registered as version 21. So let's go back to this interface and actually find this model. So here we see Our model is registered as 21, 10, 11, conference, Azure Day. So I can click on this model. I see here the version name, the description, the framework. I can see the artifacts that are there, everything that was in the outputs directory. So here we see the labels. I don't recommend clicking on this. We can see where this model is deployed. It's deployed nowhere. And I don't think datasets will do anything here, no. But what we can do is we can click on the run ID and connect back to the training run that has actually generated this model. So here we can go to metrics and here we will see the same graphs. So that is all versioned. We can go to the outputs, we can read the log files, and we can go to snapshots where we will find the training file that was being used. So everything nicely compacted under that and grouped under that specific run. And from this run, we can also go back to which input data set was used. So now we can say model.download it. So let's download the model. And here I have a small inference script that will actually load in the model, go through the directory test, and we'll start predicting on these images. So let's see what this model has done today. Okay, it is trained pretty well. It's like 84% sure that this is Bart, this is Homer. It is also sure about Lisa, this training run, Mr. Burns. We can use some more data or different data. Krusty, yeah. But it is actually working with like 3 minutes of training. So that is pretty cool. Now we have our model. We have created an experiment. Looked at how you can get like a training file. We've created an estimator, submitted that estimator to the cluster, and then when we were happy, we registered our model and we tested it. So now it is time to actually get this model running in a production endpoint or testing endpoint or somewhere that someone can actually use it. So for that, we need, of course, the model, a scoring file, and an environment file. These three together, we will wrap up in a Docker file, and we will deploy it. So how does the scoring file look like? There is an init method. It will actually load your model. And then there is a run method that will do predictions against your model and probably do some pre-processing for your on your incoming data. Then there is an environment file that will specify which additional packages needs to be installed in that container. And you combine them into an inference config. So you say runtime is Python, this is my entry script, this is my environment file. And then we can start deploying that configuration to an Azure Container instance or to a linked Azure Kubernetes service. Deploying to an Azure Container instance is two lines. We create a deployment configuration, CPUs and memory. And we say model deploy it with this inference config and with this deployment config under this name. So let's do that. So we can end up with a model that will actually run in the cloud. So we have a scoring file. Loading in the model, loading the model, loading the labels, and then we get some incoming data, we pre-process, we do the predictions against it, and we return the output scoring file. The environment file is here, HTML default, Torch Vision, and Pillow need to be installed, and we combine them in an inference config. We can also load in a model by just saying, give me the latest version of PyTorch. So we're not going to deploy it because it takes 15 minutes for a model to be deployed. So I've deployed a previous version, version 20. So we create a deployment config. And here you can see I take the recommended specification from my model. So model resource configuration. This is the GPUs and this is the memory. And then we say deploy. We can connect to any previous endpoint and we can ask for the scoring URI. And now we can start doing predictions against it. So this one wants an input as URL. So basically we have to type here and then we can start doing predictions. So the easiest way to test that is to use ACI service that run method, where we can automatically post JSON to it and it will grab the result here and we don't have to be bothered with writing a JSON client in Python, which is not too hard, but this is of course easier. So I have a text file with six URLs in it, actually the same as that we've used for the previous training. And it is now posting them one by one to the endpoint. and creating this graph for us. So here we see model 20 is 89% sure about Carcinogenic Clown, so it trained a little bit better, and the input image is also a little bit different. And March and Lisa, it is not so sure. So now we can go back to our models, go to version 20, and here under endpoints, we see where this model is actually running. So we can click on the model, see which model is here, and then trace back to actually where the data came from. 2 GB, see which Git repository is there. So this is actually the Git repository for if you want to do it yourself. So I think we're about time. So I want to open up for any questions.
Thank you, Hank. No, for now I haven't question on chat.
We don't have any questions. Okay.
No, your session is very good.
Either it is clear enough, yes, or not. So I want to invite everyone, if you want to play with this and you run into any troubles, please just find me on Twitter. Go to my GitHub for the code repositories. And on my blog, there are some more extended tutorials on how actually to get started with this service.
Okay, thank you. I share your link now, and thank you, and good luck.
Oh yeah, I see some questions still. Is it possible to work with ML servers on Azure using other languages? Yeah, you can use R. I haven't tried it, but you can the support is there.
Okay. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.